Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
I'm looking at my pocket, proclaiming the gospel. Well, that's not what was happening. I was making sure that my microphone was working this morning. If I could get just a little bit more volume, Welcome to worship on the seventh Sunday of Easter, our seventh week of celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Thank you for our musicians, a little extra music this morning, so I appreciate that. And happy Mother's Day to the mothers in our midst. We'll have a blessing for mothers at the conclusion. We have, as has been our custom the last few years, we have Passion Sunday. We'll remember those who are sponsoring children around the world. And we will receive the sacrament. Praise God for the resurrection of Jesus. To begin that, let us stand and sing together, Lord, I lift your name on By your Spirit, transform us and your beloved world, that we may find our joy in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Stay here.
Something good in there, I'm sure. Well, when I'm coming in, it's a great, I just thought of that, like 5 minutes ago. Our first reading from Acts takes place in the days between Jesus' ascension and Pentecost Day. Peter oversees the process whereby one of the members of the community of believers is chosen to be the called apostle, in order to fill the vacancy created by Jesus' preparatory death. The second reading, John writes that God has witnessed the gift of eternal life in Jesus Christ. Whoever believes in the Son of God, believes in the witness of God, has the promise of eternal life.
The first reading is from Acts. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers. Together, the crowd numbered about 120 persons. He said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became the guide for those arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us, and there was allotted his share in the ministry. So one of the men who had accompanied us during all that time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day that he was taken up from us. One of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed two, Joseph called Barabbas, who was also known as Justice and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We read responsibly, Psalm 1. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the ways of sinners, nor sat in the seat of the scornful.
Their delight is in the law of the Lord, and they meditate on his law day and night.
They are like the trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which with him blows away.
Therefore the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked is doomed.
A second reading is a reading from 1 John. If we receive human testimony, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God, that he has testified to his Son. Those who believe in the Son of God have the testimony in their hearts. Those who do not believe in God have made him a liar by not believing the testimony God has given concerning his Son. And this is the testimony. God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you. And I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is true. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace and mercy and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm going to speak this morning about Jesus' high priestly prayer from the 17th chapter of the Gospel of John. Talks all about this being in the world but not of the world, and that theme reoccurs throughout the epistle of John, our second reading. And so it directs us back to that as John continues to talk about what it means to be in the world but not of the world. But rather, I'd like to look more at our second reading from the Epistle of John, where John talks about having life and point out that John is really contrasting for us and inviting us to consider in our minds the difference between being alive and having life. Being alive is different than having life, as John the Evangelist writes about it in this epistle reading. Our reading this morning ended. God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. Even if they are alive. So this is a different way of thinking than how we normally think of life. Your heart's beating, you're respirating, your brain is operating, then you're alive. But is that life? Is that having life? I was reading an article from Astrobiology. I'm sure everybody gets that term at home, right? I was reading it out loud. Astrobiology. And the article was about life, because as you might imagine, astrobiology is about life in the cosmos. And the question really is often posed, well, how would we define that? How would we identify life if it was different than the life that we have on planet Earth? So here are the opening sentences of this article from 2010, Astrobiology magazine. Astrobiologists are committed to studying life in the cosmos, the terran life we know here on Earth, as well as the extraterran life we do not know but hope to encounter. But what exactly do we see? The question is hardly new, nor is the recognition of its difficulty. Also not new is a certain imprecision in the language used to address this question, and therefore an imprecision in the content of ideas. Daniel Koshlik recently provided an anecdote that illustrates this imprecision. As president of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, who publishes the prestigious journal Science, Koshlin recounted his own experience with a committee that was charged to generate a definition of life. Here's a quote from that article. What is the definition of life? I remember a conference, the scientific elite, that sought to answer that question. Is an enzyme alive? Is a virus alive? Is a cell alive? After many hours of launching promising balloons to define life in a sentence, followed by equally inclusive punctures of those balloons, a solution seemed at hand. The ability to reproduce, that is the essential characteristic of life, said one statesman of science. Everyone nodded in agreement that the essentials of a life was the ability to reproduce, until one small voice was heard. Then, one rabbit is dead. Two rabbits, a male and a female, are alive. Either one alone is dead. At that point, we all became convinced. So the article confuses this notion of being alive and having life. But we as Christians are given guidance in understanding what having life is about. That guidance is found in our scriptures. We understand that having life is not about accumulating stuff. Having life is not about getting stuff. Having life is not about accumulating and grabbing it. The way that the world defines life. And then just a few years ago, J.C. Penney's was using the tagline, the good life. As if you would find the good life by buying stuff from a department store. Our faith tells us something different. That we have life in Jesus Christ. And gathering stuff, and collecting stuff, and buying stuff, and accumulating stuff, and possessing and having is not having life. It might have something to do with being alive. But you and I are well aware people who are alive do not have life. John writes, God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life, and whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. Having life has to do with the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Lucretius, whose story is recounted in this article from Master Biology, I think they were onto something that they didn't even understand. That we as Christians have more insight into. Having life has to do with relationship. Especially relationship with God in Jesus Christ. One rabbit alone is dead because it can't reproduce. But one rabbit in relationship with God has life. One person alone, accumulating, amassing wealth, property, and whatever other way you might define the greatness of their life, one human alone does not have life. Because life, having life, is being in relationship with God. Read that again. God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. We have the Son of God through faith. We have the Son of God in our relationship with Jesus Christ. There's another clue to this understanding of having life, not merely being alive, merely eating food, giving off carbon dioxide. Having life has to do with love, another relationship word, right? The third chapter of this same epistle of 1 John, John writes, the children of God and the children of the devil are revealed in this way. All who do not do what is right are all who do not do what is right are not from God, nor are those who do not love their brothers and sisters. For this is the message you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We must not be like Cain, who was from the evil one and murdered his brother. Why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous. Do not be astonished, brothers and sisters, that the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love one another. Whoever does not love abides in death. All who hate a brother or sister are murderers, and you know that murderers do not have eternal life abiding in them. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us. We ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister and it refuses to help? Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in truth and action. As John does in his epistle, it's very compact. But here again, the line in the middle, we know we have passed from death to life because we love one another. Let's ask the biologists and their rabbits their definition. Remind us of how having life is found in relationship. Relationship us with God and relationship us with one another. The body of Christ all together here with Christ as the head who gives life to the body. John's epistle mixes all of these things, the world, the spirit, life, death, love of God, and love of those around us. We have life. We are alive, as are many around us, but we have life through Jesus Christ, who dwells in us with the Holy Spirit, who calls us children of God and makes it so, who fills us with love so that our love overflows to those who are around us. This is the gospel message. You have life in you through your relationship with God and Jesus Christ. And you know that life dwells in you when you have love for one another. Thanks be to God, who loved us first, revealed that love for us in Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
divisions within your church, O God. Open us to receive your testimony. Make us one as you are one. Make our joy complete. And hear our prayers of thanksgiving for the anniversary of baptism this week. Carol Shue, Emily Truck, Maxine Ashley, Susan Beckman, Sharon Carthen, Paul Thompson, James Parker, Joyce Quarantine, Georgia Johnson, Todd Martin. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Nourish the soil of your earth, O Holy God. Bless the trees planted by the water. Bless the seeds planted by birds and by our hands. Bring forth fruit in due season. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for warring nations, political refugees, and peacekeepers. Wash away the fear and hatred that tear us apart. Let justice roll down like a mighty stream. Quench our thirst for peace in every land. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who are homeless, naked, hungry, in prison, abandoned, or sick. We pray especially for the family of James, Doris, Bob, Barrett, Melvin, James, Al, Jim, Preston, Brad, Elaine, Jim, Lois, Trudy, Jean, Eric, Jada, Rick, Bob, Phyllis, Steve, Karen, Carol, Larry, Tim, Elsa, Carleen, Betty, Connie, and those in and out, silent or loud. Send us shelter, clothe, feed, and visit those in need. Make us your healing and compassionate presence in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for mothers we love, mothers we struggle to love, for adoptive mothers, stepmothers, and foster mothers, for those who long to be mothers, for everyone who has mothered us in the faith. Give rest, healing, wisdom, and strength, Mother and God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give you thanks for those who act as mothers in their professions and their vocations, and through compassion and likewise sponsors. Continue to pour your love upon us that we might continue to love those around us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You give us eternal life in your Son. When doubts and fears arise, give us peace in the resurrection promise. Sanctify us in your truth and unite us with all the saints. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We entrust all our prayers to you, gracious God. Receive them by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Be known to us, O Lord, in the breaking of the bread, as you were made known to us.
Receive these gifts and the offering of our lives, that we may be your risen body in the world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to
give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away the sin of the world, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us and send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love.
Come, Holy Spirit.
With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Now let us feast this Easter day on Christ, the bread of heaven. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection, you send light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of heaven to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to Jesus' resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world, through the same Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Amen.
May God, who has brought us from death to life, fill you with great joy. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for some of our...
My life is in you, Lord. My strength is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord. It's in you. My life is in you, Lord. My strength is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord. It's you. It's in you. I will praise you with all of my life. I will praise you with all of my strength. With all of my life. With all of my strength. All of my hope is in you. My life is in you, Lord. My strength is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord. In you, it's in you. My life is in you, Lord. My strength is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord.
And yes, I'm always aware when we run long and some people are like,
yeah.
And so I stop looking at my notes, but we have to say a blessing from others today. So join me in prayer. God of all creation, pour out your blessing on all mothers and those who provide motherly care. You have made them in your image and given them children to love and care for in your name. Bless them with a heart like your heart, loving and kind, comforting and strong, nurturing and grace-filled. As they participate in your ongoing creativity, give them discernment to help their children discover their unique gifts. As they teach your children, grant them wisdom to know what is truly valuable. As they strive to share your unconditional love, give them long-suffering patience and a lively sense of humor. As they model your mercy, help them extend the forgiveness they themselves freely receive from you in all circumstances. Fortify their faith that they may love you above all. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
You are the body of Christ raised up for the world. Go in peace. Share the good news.
Thanks be to God.